Today, I am going to talk on important diseases of silkworm. We will be covering the following points in today's lecture: introduction, various diseases, protozoan disease, pepperine, bacterial disease, bacterial flagellae and septicemia, viral disease, infectious flagellae and Gracilis, fungal disease, Muscardine and aspergillosis. Introduction. Like all other organisms, silkworms are also susceptible to diseases. So we will start with the first disease, protozoan disease. Positive organism is Nosema bombensis. A protozoan Nosema bombensis causes pepperine disease. Mode of infection. Occurs by three routes: oral, contact, and transoral. Oral route, this mode of infection occurs when the larvae feeds on infected leaves. Contact, if there are open wounds on the body of the larvae, then this protozoan spores and spheres inside the body, causing pepperine disease. In transovarian, if the adult moth is infected, then her ovary is also infected and the eggs are also infected. So such adult silkworms, they lay pepperine infected eggs. Now, next point is symptoms. All four stages are affected by pepperine disease. So symptoms in case of egg. In case of egg, you will find that the eggs are not in a circular fashion. They are not laid uniformly on the egg sheet, but they are overlapping and irregular. For example, if you see a normal egg, they are properly arranged in a circle. But if it is an infected egg, then it will be something like this. So it is not uniform, it is one over the other. Okay, so such eggs are to be discarded. Now, if you see the symptoms in case of larvae, you will find on the body of the larvae black spots. So this disease, pepperine means pepper like spots. Pepperine means pepper like. So you will find pepper like black spots on the body of larvae. So such larvae are to be discarded. In case of pupa, also you will find that the last instar larvae spin a very flimsy cocoon and the pupa inside is infected. So if you see an infected pupa, you will find, so these are the appendages, being pad, abdomen. Okay, so on it you will find black spots. You will find black spots on the body of pupa, especially in the abdominal region. So such pupa fail to evolve into adult at most of the time. And finally, fourth stage is adult. In case of adult, you will find if this is the thorax and this is the abdomen, this is the antenna. On the body, we find the scales fall off. Scales fall off, wings deform, even the antenna is also deformed. Okay, so these are the symptoms which you find in all the four stages. Now control measures. Prevention and control. Usually you have to purchase eggs from some sericulture institute where you will get good quality egg shells. Then when you are rearing, at that time every day during bed cleaning, you have to observe the larvae. If you find any larvae infected, then that particular larvae has to be destroyed, and rearing room, rearing appliances, everything has to be disinfected by 100% formalin. If you find the adult is infected, then such adults are to be destroyed. They should not be allowed to lay eggs, because if they lay eggs, the eggs will also be infected. Now we move on to the next disease, bacterial disease. Now the next disease is bacterial flagellum. This is a bacterial disease. Flagellum word represents vomiting and diarrhea. Now, this disease is caused by Bacillus bombicis and Bacillus bombicornis. Okay, Bacillus bombicis and Bacillus bombicornis. As the disease progresses, different other bacteria have also been isolated. Around 29 different bacteria have been isolated in different stages. Now, mode of transmission. This disease spreads by oral route. That means when the larvae feeds on infected leaves, at that time the disease occurs. If you see the symptoms, the larvae becomes sluggish. It slows down. It doesn't feed. As it slows down, it doesn't feed. There is loss of appetite. Because of that, its growth is retarded. So you will find the infected larvae are smaller in size than the regular larvae. So suppose you have a regular larvae, Okay, so a regular larvae is larger in size, whereas infected larvae is smaller in size. Then its skin becomes inelastic. And it looks flaccid. Over a period of time, death occurs. The larvae becomes black in color and emits foul odor. Dirty smell. Next point is prevention and control. As the infection occurs through oral route due to infected leaves, we have to see that we provide good quality leaves. So, good quality leaves, the leaves should be free from diseases, free from dust and infection. Then there should be optimum condition in the rearing room. Optimum conditions means temperature, relative humidity have to be optimum depending upon the stage of the bulb, because different stages require different temperature and humidity. So that has to be maintained properly. Next point is you have to always keep on checking. Always keep on checking when you are doing bed cleaning. Keep on checking if you find any worm which is smaller in size, which is lagging behind in growth, then it is sure to be infected by this disease. Then vomiting, diarrhea, such things also you can observe during bed cleaning, and you will have to discard such worms and go for disinfection. Now we move on to the next disease, that is septicemia. Septicemia is again a bacterial disease. The earlier one that we studied, bacterial flagelli, that affected the alimentary canal of the silkworm. In this disease, you will find it affects the hemolymph. So, different strains, different varieties of bacillus, streptococcus, staphylococcus, cause this disease. Bacillus, streptococcus, staphylococcus, different varieties of this genus, they cause septicemia. Now, mode of transmission is both oral route and contact. So, oral route is by infected leaves. And contact, open wounds. Now, next point is symptoms. Again, here you will find if the larvae becomes sluggish, it does not feed, growth is retarded. Because of continuous vomiting and diarrhea, flaccid power is lost. So the prolegs are not able to hold the mulberry leaves. Okay, so the flaccid power is lost, and finally death and foul odor here also in septic area. Prevention and control of this disease. Oral route is through the infected leaves. Therefore, here we need to give them fresh, good quality leaves. Okay, then other mode was through worms. So, when you are handling the worms, when you are handling the silk worms, you have to see that you handle them properly. There should not be any wound on the body of the larvae. In addition to this, there should be proper temperature, regulation of relative humidity of the room. There should be proper spacing in the tray. There should not be overcrowding. Feeding should be done on time. You should not overfeed them, or you should not starve them. Because if they are starving, they will feed on the dried leaves of last feed that you had given, and there is every possibility of increasing the chances of infection. So we end with our both bacterial diseases, bacterial flagellae and septicemia. Now the third disease is caused by virus. Okay, so here we are having two diseases, infectious flagellae and gracilis. Most viral disease is infectious flagellae. So this disease is caused by infectious flagellae virus, Bombyx mori. Okay, this is a RNA virus. It does not form polyhedra. Incubation period is 7 to 12 days. Incubation period of this virus is 7 to 10 or 12 days. Mode of infection is oral route and also through open wounds. Oral route, as we have seen previously, is because of infected leaves. And if there are wounds on the body, then again infection, there is chances of infection. This disease, you will find the virus specifically targets the goblet cells. The virus targets the goblet cells, and eventually it spreads to the columnar cells also. Okay, so next point is symptoms. When this infection occurs, the larvae, it loses its appetite, stops eating. Additionally, it vomits out everything from its gut. It vomits out everything from its gut, and therefore it appears translucent or transparent. And over a period of time, death occurs. Alright, prevention and control.
you will find ki the larvae which are vomiting and which are not feeding properly, they are smaller in size, right? So such smaller size worms which are not in what you say growing along with the regular worms, such worms are to be removed. And rearing bed, rearing tray, rearing room, rearing appliances, everything has to be disinfected. Good quality use should be given. Okay, so giving good quality use and disinfection are the main prevention and control measures for infectious Plantulae virus. Next viral disease is Gracilis. It is also called as nuclear polyhedrosis. It is also called as jaundice or milky worm disease. The virus that causes this disease is nuclear polyhedrosis virus, Bombyx mori. This is a DNA virus and it forms polyhedra. Because of the formation of polyhedra, the body becomes internally white in color and the skin loses its elasticity. So skin inelastic, and if you press the worm, the skin ruptures and white milky fluid comes out. Therefore this worm is called as milky worm. Okay, again the worm which is infected is very restless. It keeps moving on the tray and falls from the tray. You will find many such infected worms hanging from the tray by their four legs. Therefore, they are also called as hanging worms. Eventually, the worms die, fall on the ground and die. And when they die, they look yellow in color. Therefore, this disease is also called as jaundice disease. Now, prevention and control. You have to give good quality use. Maintain hygienic condition. Clean rearing or hygienic rearing should be done, and all conditions have to be optimum. Because what happens is, when formalin infected leaves are given, then this disease occurs. Then when the spiracles are blocked because of dust, this disease occurs. So you have to see that the leaves do not have dust and the rearing room is clean and tidy. Okay, so hygienic rearing will help in reducing the virus disease Gracilis. Now the last one is fungal disease. So the next causative organism is fungus. Fourth causative organism is fungus, and the first disease caused by fungus is muscardine. Muscardine, in this disease you will find mummification of the worm. Occurs. Here we will be studying white muscardine. White muscardine is also called as calcino. Calcino means chalky white. Calcino means chalky white. This disease is caused by the fungus Viverrea bassiana. In this disease, what happens is the fungal spores enter inside the body of the larvae and they grow on the skin of the larvae. The mycelia penetrates inside the body, hyphae come up. So these mycelia, they take nutrition from the neolymph and they go inside the body. They come out, the conidia comes out. Conidia is having white spores. Because of that, whole body appears white and the worm shrinks in size. It becomes hard and is white, mummified worm. Okay, so this is muscardine disease. Now, how to prevent this disease? Prevention and control. Muscardine is usually caused when the conditions in the rearing room is hot and humid. We have to take proper care that the temperature should be optimal. It should not be too hot. Usually 26 degree is required for the newly hatched larvae and 23 for the last instar larvae. So we have to maintain that temperature. Humidity also has to be regulated. It has to be at the optimum level. During rainy season, proper ventilation should be there in the rearing room. There should be good ventilation in the rearing room. Then additionally, we have to go for various disinfectants. There are various bed disinfectants. So every time you are going for bed changing, you have to apply calcium carbonate powder. Alright, so anhydrous calcium carbonate is hygroscopic. It absorbs excess moisture and prevents the muscardine disease. In addition, various bed disinfectants are Labex, then Ration Kill Rupture. So these are also very effective. You have to apply it in the bed, rearing bed, before molting and after molting to prevent infection of muscardine disease. Then chaff. Husk chaff is also used. This is quite effective. Every time when you are doing bed cleaning, 30 minutes before bed cleaning, you will have to apply it. So these are some of the methods by which we can prevent muscardine disease. Why muscardine? Now muscardine disease is, as it is mummification of the worm, and colors are different. You will find white muscardine, black muscardine, red muscardine, yellow, green, depending upon the color of the spores on the conidia. Alright, so one of them that we have seen today is the white muscardine. Now the second fungal disease is aspergillosis.
organism, the causative fungus is Aspergillus flavus. Okay, now Aspergillus flavus, this causes aspergillosis, and in this condition you will find the mummification or hardening occurs only at the infected areas. So suppose this is the location where infection has occurred, so only this portion will become hard, rest of the portion will not become hard, and this particular fungus grows on the surface only. It grows on the surface only, it doesn't enter inside, doesn't feed on the hemosis. Only this much area is affected. Many times when the larvae molds, automatically the dead skin is shed and it loses all the infection, becomes a normal larvae. But if the infection persists, then there is mummification at particular points which are dark brown or dirty brown in color, and whole body rots. Okay, whole body will rot and the organism will die. So this occurs in aspergillosis. Prevention and control measures are same as mustarding. Optimum temperature, optimum relative humidity, good quality leaves. There should be clean rearing room. Bed cleaning has to be done regularly. You have to give good quality leaves. Proper spacing should be there. And you have to apply calcium carbonate, anhydrous calcium carbonate powder or lagase or nation ki roshan as bed disinfectant to prevent the spread of aspergillosis. The fungal diseases are found to be more prevalent during the rainy season because of more humidity and less ventilation. So controlling the humidity and proper ventilation in the rearing room will help in prevention of muscarding and aspergillosis. So in general, for all the diseases that we have seen, main points are you have to keep the rearing room clean, hygienic rearing should be there, good quality leaves are to be supplied to the silkworms, spacing should be proper. When you are handling the worms, see that the worms are not wounded. So all these are the common points for all the diseases. So here we end up with important diseases of silkworm. Thank you.